Steps to life is opening God's word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for his soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change your life.
I would like to study with you from the Bible a very familiar story, a story that I have studied with God's people many times, many places, and lately I've been reviewing it again, and we were studying it together in Hutchinson earlier today, and it's found in the 15th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. If you would like to turn there, we will read from verses 11 to 32. It says, "Then he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me.' So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. And when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight and am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they begin to be merry. For now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf.' But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, 'Lo, these many years I have been serving you, I never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him.' And he said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found.'" Now there are several points mentioned in this story. We cannot look at every single one of them. I'm discovering more in this story all the time. Notice first of all, it was the younger son that wanted the inheritance to be divided right away between him and his brother. Now today we have sociologists that do studies about things like this, differences between the older and younger children in the family. And here's some things that the sociologists tell us. And it's very interesting that this story that Jesus told fits quite well with the sociological data that the sociologists today tell us about the younger and the older sons. For instance, the sociologists tell us that the oldest child is generally more conservative. Not only that, the oldest child generally has a more hard-driving personality. He's more of a high achiever. Number three, the oldest child generally relates and identifies with the parent's value system. And number four, the oldest child is generally less sociable and less well-liked in school. But when we look at the sociology data for the youngest children, we find, number one, that they are much more sociable. They like to have a good time. Number two, we find that they are much better liked by their peers in school. Number three, we find they're much more of a happy-go-lucky type of a personality. Number four, we find that they do not identify so closely with parental values. Number five, they're not nearly so driven. They're not such high achievers as the firstborn. And number six, they're generally not nearly as self-disciplined or motivated. Now, those things don't mean, of course, that they don't achieve success in life. Some of these younger children might become star salesmen in the workforce and make lots of money because they're very sociable. And they like to interact with people. They like to have a good time. And this data is very interesting when you look at this story, because it was the younger one who came to his father and he said he wanted his portion of the inheritance right away. And of course, the reason he wanted it is because he wanted to have a good time. No doubt his father knew that when he asked him. And one of the first things that we see in this story when we look at this younger boy, we see the selfishness of sin. He came to his father and he said, "I know you have two sons. Half of your estate will belong to me, but I want my half now. Give me what I deserve now. I want it now." How would you feel if you were the father? He said, in effect, "I want what I want, and I deserve it, and I want it now." And so the story says, it was no doubt with a breaking heart, but his father says in verse 12, he divided to them his livelihood. Concerning the selfishness of sin, Ellen White has this to say. She says, "Selfishness is the essence of depravity." In another place, she says, "The principle of worldlings is to get, and thus they expect to secure happiness. But carried out in all its bearings, the fruit is misery and death." Some years ago, I was taking a walk on Sabbath afternoon with a person who had a fairly high position in a certain Adventist institution, quite a large one. And this person and I were talking about the fact, and we both knew it, I'd worked at that institution too. We both knew that there really wasn't very much equity or justice in the wage system they had at this institution. And this person let me know that they weren't interested in tolerating any injustice. They wanted their fair share from the system. And that's what this young boy wanted. He says, "My fair share is 50%, and I want it, and I want it now." The selfishness of sin. Sin is the essence of depravity. And selfishness has filled the world with misery and strife, setting human beings at variance with one another. But the selfishness is just the beginning. The second thing we see is the separation that is caused by sin. Because in just a little while, as you see, this younger son left his father's house. He no doubt took his money. He probably couldn't carry all the gold and silver it would amount to, so he had to convert it to banknotes. But you could convert it to banknotes in those days, just like you can today. And he no doubt converted this money into banknotes so that he could carry it with him, and he left home. And so we see the separation that is caused by sin. And Jesus went through this. Concerning the separation that Jesus experienced and felt, Ellen White says the following. She says, "The separation that sin makes between God and man was fully realized and keenly felt by the innocent, suffering man of Calvary. He was oppressed by the powers of darkness. He had not one ray of light to brighten the future." So, Jesus knew how it felt. He was separated. He was separated from his Father. He knew what it meant to be all alone. And when you're separated from man, that's bad. But when you're separated from God, you're all alone, and it leads to hopelessness. Ellen White says it was sin that separated man from God, and it is sin that maintains this separation. And yet he wanted to go away from home. He wanted to go away from home. He wanted to be separated. Even though that was the biggest disaster of his life, that's what he wanted. Why did he want it? Ellen White explains it in Christ Object Lessons, page 200. She says, "There is nothing that the sinner bent on self indulgence and sinful pleasures desires so much as separation from God." And so, he wanted to be separated from his father's house because he wanted to do things that he couldn't do at home. And so, he left home. He was separated from home because he was bent on self-indulgence and sinful pleasures, which were not allowed in his father's house. But a third thing that we notice when we look at the beginning of this story in Luke 15 about the younger son, the third thing we notice is the ingratitude of sin. The ingratitude of sin. This younger son made no response to his father's love. He had no gratitude for the years and care and tenderness that had been his in his father's house. He rendered no service of love or gratitude to his parents. He decided to seek happiness in forgetfulness of God, and he claimed the good things of his father as his by right. He took the blessings of his father's home as a matter of course, and he made no return of gratitude. And this is another terrible thing about sin. The ingratitude of sin. But notice how quick it happened in verse 13. It said, "And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country." Not many days. Just a little while. This shows us the impatience of sin. He was not willing to wait for the future to receive his inheritance. His thoughts were centered on the present, and he wanted what he wanted right now. He wanted to enter into his kingdom now. He wanted present enjoyment, selfish indulgence now. And so we see in the life of the younger son the impatience of sin. But then in the last part of verse 13, we see something awful too. It says when he got to the far country that there he wasted his possessions with prodigal living. The wastefulness of sin. He wasted his time. He was wasting his time in sinful pleasure. He wasted his money. He wasted all of his resources. He wasted his mind. He wasn't studying the Bible. He wasn't going to church. He wasn't going to prayer meeting. He was wasting his mind in sinful pleasure and self-indulgence. Not only that, he was wasting his body. The Bible says that any sin that you commit is outside your body. But if you commit fornication, you sin against your own body. So he was wasting his own body. And when you waste, what's the result? The result is you end up with terrible losses. And the wastefulness of sin results in a terrible, terrible loss. So he experienced the loss of his health. He experienced the loss of the fellowship of the saints. Do you know, people today, because we live in a land of religious liberty, people don't appreciate the fellowship of the saints. One of these days we'll appreciate it when we don't have it very much anymore. The early Christians appreciated the fellowship of the saints so much they would meet in secret. In France, they used to meet in secret at midnight, way out in the forest, so that they could get together and study the Bible and pray together. He missed all of that. He lost the fellowship of the saints. And he lost the service that he could have rendered to his father and to his family. And he lost the satisfaction that comes from doing God's will. And he lost peace of mind. And how much did he lose? Look at verse 14. It said, when he had spent all. So he lost everything. The wastefulness of sin leads to losing everything. And that brings us to point number 6. And that is the poverty of sin. The poverty of sin. The devil's trying to convince our children and our young people that you can go into the way of sin and you will get great gain. But the Bible teaches that the way of sin is a way of poverty. And what did he lose? Well, he lost his home right off the bat. He lost his possessions. He lost his inheritance. He lost his health. And finally, he lost all of his friends. Out there in a far country, he was all alone without friends, family, money, possessions, inheritance, or health. And it says here in verse 14 and 15 that when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And this leads us to point number 7. And that is the deceptiveness of sin. The Bible teaches that sin is deceptive. You see, he thought that he was going to get pleasure, but now what did he have? He had misery. In a Jewish mind, having to take care of pigs was about as low as you could go. He thought he would have happiness, but what did he have? He had sorrow. He thought he would have wealth, but what did he have? Poverty. He thought he would have friends, but what did he have? Loneliness. He thought everything would get better, but everything got worse. The deceptiveness of sin. The Apostle Paul teaches very clearly that sin is deceptive. And when he was out there feeding those swine and eating those husks, those pods, he began to learn about the deceptiveness of sin. He had been conned. He thought he was going to get everything, and he'd lost everything. And that leads me to point number 8. And point number 8 is the degradation of sin. Sin degrades a person. They may not always know it every day. But sin degrades a person. It degrades the mind, first of all, and the spirit. How low can sin take you? I'm going to read you how low sin can take you. How low can sin degrade a human being? Here's how low it can take you. It's a quotation from the Review and Herald, 1896. When Pilate spoke again to them concerning Jesus, the hoarse cry was raised, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Through yielding to demonic agencies, men were led to take their stand on the side of the great apostate. Unfallen worlds looked upon the scene with amazement, unable to comprehend the degradation that sin had wrought. So how low can it take you? How low can sin take you? How low can it degrade you? It can degrade you to the point where men screamed out to crucify the majesty of heaven. That's how low it can take you. Let's think that through in very practical terms. Why did they want to crucify Jesus? Why were they so angry at him? Because his very presence was a rebuke to their sins. His purity rebuked their impurity. His holiness rebuked their unholiness. And so, they wanted to get rid of him. Having him around was to have something at cross purposes with what you wanted to do. Now think this through. If there's somebody that disagrees with you, that thinks completely different from you on something, and if you want some harm or hurt to come to them, you're going down the same road they went. Sin is degrading. It degraded those people so much, it says that the unfallen worlds looked on it and they couldn't comprehend how much they had been degraded. And that's what happened to this younger son. He became degraded by sin. While he was out there, it says in verse 17, he's out there feeding the swine and he was hungry, didn't have anything to eat, and nobody gave him anything. It says in verse 17, when he came to himself. That brings me to point number 9. What does it mean when he came to himself? It means that finally, he could hear the voice of conscience speaking to him. Before, there'd been too much noise in his life. You know what I mean? You ever had a friend? And they are so busy and so preoccupied and so totally engrossed with everything that they're doing that they don't ever hear the voice of conscience. And it can even be doing good things. They're so totally engrossed, they don't even hear the still small voice. And that's exactly what the devil wants to happen. Let me read something to you. This is from In Heavenly Places 3:46. It says, Satan uses his influence to drown the voice of God and the voice of conscience. The devil is trying to drown the voice of God and the voice of conscience so that you and I won't hear it. And this young boy hadn't been hearing it. He'd been so preoccupied with sinful pleasures and self-indulgence and everything that he wanted to do, he'd been so preoccupied, the voice of conscience, remember it's a still small voice? There'd been so much noise in his life, it was drowned out. He didn't even hear it. But now he's out there feeding the pigs. He's out feeding the pigs. And things quiet down enough in his mind, he can hear the voice of conscience speaking to him. And the Bible says, finally he came to himself. Do you know that this, what we're talking about right now, is one, and I say this respectfully of God, but this is one of God's biggest problems. One of God's biggest problems. The Holy Spirit is trying to speak to our conscience, through our conscience. But oftentimes there's so much noise we can't hear. How does God speak through the conscience? Well, Ellen White mentions three things as to how the voice of conscience is heard. She says it is heard through warnings, through counsels, and through reproofs. That's how the voice of conscience is heard. But very often, and by the way, this is what makes it very scary to engage in intercessory prayer. Because sometimes you don't know what we're asking for. And we say, Lord, please reach this person's conscience. Do you know what you're asking? Do you know what God has to do sometimes so that things quiet down enough so that we hear the voice of conscience? Sometimes people land in a hospital bed or in a prison cell. Some weeks ago there was a man and his wife that visited us here at Steps to Life. And he was telling me just a little bit about his experience along this very line. He was just baptized in 1996 as a Seventh-day Adventist. But he had heard about the Seventh-day Adventist message a long time before that. He had, I think it was right over here in Kansas City. He had gone to a Revelation seminar. And he'd heard the Adventist message clear back in the early 80s, somewhere around 81, 82, 83, along in there. He'd heard the Adventist message and he believed it. And he started going to an Adventist church. It was a conference church. He started going to this Adventist church. And as he was attending this Adventist church and looking around, he got confused. What he saw in church and what he heard, he couldn't put it all together. He just couldn't figure it all out. So finally, he just got discouraged and left the church. And he told me, he says, when I left, he said, I went deeper into sin than I'd ever been before. Now, his type of going deep into sin was to make a lot of money. And he was involved in the graphic arts industry. And he got a very high-paying job. He was a supervisor over other people. And he was making big money. And he told me, he says, that was my whole life. Just making big money. And for several years, he made really big money. Now, in the back of his mind, he knew about the Sabbath. He knew about the mark of the beast. He knew about the end of time. He knew about the second coming. He knew about all those things. But that was in the back of his mind. There was too much noise in his life. He was busy doing something else. And he told me, he said, God had to take me right down to the bottom and put me on my back and take my job away from me and take everything with me and let me go clear to the bottom until I found out that I needed to make a change in my life. And I finally told the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm giving in. And he surrendered his heart to the Lord. And then all of a sudden the Lord turned a whole bunch of things around in his life. The voice of conscience. It's heard in warnings, counsels, and reproofs. But this younger son couldn't hear the voice for a long time because he was too busy. He was too busy living his sinful lifestyle. But when he finally did listen to this voice of conscience, notice verses 17 to 19. It says, when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. He got clear to the bottom, and then he made a decision that he was going to repent. To repent, by the way, comes from a Greek word that simply means you're going to completely change your mind. If you repent and you're going this way, you turn around and go that way. That's what repentance means. You turn around. He had been going away from home, but now he's going to turn around and he's going to go back home because he's repented. And he's not only going to turn around, he already formulated his mind what he was going to say when he got home. He was going to confess. He's going to repent and confess. That's point number 10. He decided he was going to repent and confess. He got clear to the bottom and he decided he was going to repent and confess and go back home. However, we see in what he says here, make me like one of your hired servants. This is point number 11. We see something else here about sin. It's the misunderstanding of sin. What did he not understand? What he didn't understand was the love that was in his father's heart. And so because he didn't understand the love in his father's heart, he didn't understand his father really at all. He said, well, I'll go home and I'll see if my father will let me be one of the hired servants. I'll see if he'll let me do that. And so he decided to go home. And it says in verse 20, he arose and came to his father. This is point number 12. Salvation from sin is not complicated. Salvation from sin is not complicated. If you are in the far country, all you have to do is decide if you want to repent and confess your sins and go back home, you can. Even if you've been a terrible sinner. This man was a terrible sinner. We already have seen. He was impatient. He didn't have any gratitude. He was selfish. He was degraded. He was ruined. But yet, he decided to repent and to confess his sin and to go back home. And that's all anybody has to do if they want to be saved. If you're willing to repent and confess and go back home, you can be saved. But now, we come to the most wonderful and also the most awful part of the story. It says in verse 20, when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they begin to be merry. This boy on that occasion found out something. He found out that love is of quick sight. It says that his father recognized him from a great way off. Love is of quick sight. That's actually true. And his father went and he took him. And he wouldn't let him be a servant. He made him a son again. He restored to him the full privileges that he had had before he left home. And it says they began to be merry. There was great rejoicing. The Bible says that there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels over one sinner that repents. That's in this same chapter in verse 10 and also in verse 7. And so there was great rejoicing over this lost boy that had come home. But now we're going to find out that while there was one brother who was lost in the far country, there was another brother, the older brother, who was lost at home right in the church. This older brother was a leader in his family. And it says that the older brother was in the field. Notice verse 25. It says, now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Notice, this older brother, his younger brother, he probably hadn't seen his younger brother for several years. And now his younger brother is home. He's right inside there in the house. He hasn't seen him for several years, and he won't even go in and say hello. Ellen White said this about it. She said, oh, how my heart trembles for us all. Unless the hard-heartedness is melted away by the grace of Jesus Christ, we shall never know what heaven is. I am pained beyond measure when I see and feel the hard-hearted methods of dealing with the Lord's heritage. So now we're seeing in the older brother the hard-heartedness of sin. He said to the servants, "Give me an account. Tell me what's going on." And when he found out, he wouldn't go in. He wouldn't even talk to him. And it says in verse 28, he was angry. Point number 14, we see then the hostility of sin. He was angry. He was passionate, both in his thoughts and in his words, against his brother. Now think this through. The father was rejoicing. It was the happiest day in his life when his son came home. But the older brother wasn't even happy that the son came home. He was angry, it says. And from his point of view, this person had been disfellowshipped. He'd been living with harlots. And he had no right in the church. The hostility of sin. And then we come to point number 15. We already studied this before with the younger brother. When the younger brother got the inheritance, the younger brother left home. He was physically separated from the family because of his desire for sin. But the older brother was separated by sin just as much as the younger brother, even though he was right at home. Notice what he said to his father. Verse 30. He says, "As soon as this son of yours came," what is he saying there? He's not even accepting that this man is his brother. He says, "This son of yours." He is separated in his spirit and his mind from both his father and his brother. And so we see again the separation that is caused by sin. Number 16, we see the lack of sympathy that is caused by sin. The lack of sympathy that is caused by sin. He wouldn't go in. He didn't have a single good thing to say about his own brother. Now, of course, it's true. And the story doesn't deny it, that his brother was a terrible sinner. There's no question about that. The Bible doesn't deny that. The father didn't deny that. The father said that his younger son had been dead in trespasses and sins. But this older brother had no sympathy for the sinner that had come home. Point number 17. We see in this older brother the harshness of sin. Notice what he says. See if this sounds harsh to your ears. "As soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed a fatted calf for him." It's harsh and sarcastic. The harshness of sin. Ellen White says, "The harsh, unsympathetic words we sometimes hear spoken and the hard-heartedness we see manifested are wholly satanic. And this spirit must be supplanted by the Spirit of Christ." Well, we come now to point number 18. Point number 18 is the severity of sin. The severity of sin. You notice this older brother would not go in the house. He would not even say hello. He would have nothing to do with his prodigal brother. The severity of sin. And number 19, and this one is terrible, the unforgiving spirit of sin. From the standpoint of the older brother, the younger brother had been disfellowshipped, he had been disinherited, and he was not even willing to acknowledge him as his brother. You know, friends, this is the spirit of the devil, and the devil tries to instill this into the church. And in volume 5, Ellen White says, that the devil tries to make people think that God is severe and arbitrary and unforgiving. The devil tries to make people think that God is that way, but that's the way the devil is. That's not the way that God is. And then, point number 20. We see the very same thing in the older brother that we saw at the beginning in the younger brother. Remember, at the beginning, we saw that the younger brother manifested the selfishness of sin. He wanted what was his right now. But we see now the selfishness of sin in the older brother. Notice what it says in verse 29, the last part. First he says, "Lo, these many years I've been serving you." And then he says, "Yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends." What is he saying? You know what he's saying. He's saying, you didn't treat me right. You treated my younger brother, who has been living with harlots, better than you treat me. And it's not fair. It's the selfishness of sin. He says, I wasn't treated right. You didn't treat me as good as you treated my younger brother, who's been living with harlots. And then, point number 21. And this one is a serious one, too. And we see this in the older brother. It's the disrespect of sin. If you go through the Ten Commandments, you will find that one of the principal teachings of the Ten Commandments is the principle of respect or honor. It goes all through the Ten Commandments. The fifth commandment begins with that very word, honor your father and your mother. And children need to pay attention, and young people need to pay attention, and all of us that have living fathers and mothers need to pay attention to how the fifth commandment reads, because it doesn't say honor your father and your mother if they treat you right. It doesn't say that. It just says honor your father and mother, period. But sin results in disrespect, a lack of honor. This older son had so much disrespect of his father that it led him to censure and wrongfully rebuke his own father. Now, it's pretty serious any time you decide to rebuke your own father. That's pretty serious. But it's even more serious if you censure and wrongfully rebuke your own father. Notice, the father claimed, you can see that in verse 32, the father claimed that what he had done was right. And the older brother said, no, what you've done is wrong. You haven't treated me as good as my younger brother. The disrespect of sin. Now we come to number 22. And this is the self-righteousness of sin. And we see this in the older brother too. Notice what it says in verse 29. I have never transgressed your commandment at any time. That's self-righteousness. I have never transgressed your commandment at any time. I have been perfectly obedient and honorable. And yet you didn't treat me right. The self-righteousness of sin. Number 23. We see in the experience of the older brother the estrangement of sin. His heart is estranged from both his father and his brother. He's estranged. He's in the same house, the same place, but he's estranged. His body is in the church, but his heart and his spirit is somewhere else. He's estranged. The estrangement of sin. And then, number 24. we find the very same thing in the older brother that we found at the beginning in the younger brother. And that is the ungrateful spirit caused by sin. The ungrateful spirit caused by sin. Did this older brother, did he owe everything to his father just as much as the younger brother did? Of course he did. Of course he did. But instead of being thankful, he wrongfully rebuked his father and wouldn't even go in and talk or see his brother. It's the ungrateful spirit. And number 25 is similar. It's the unloving spirit of sin. When you look at the speeches that the older brother made, you see clearly revealed the unloving spirit. I wondered, if you had been the younger brother, suppose you had been the prodigal son and you were home inside and you heard the older brother talking outside, would you have wanted to just rush out and meet him? Would you? Would you? Or would you have been afraid to even go out? See, there was an unloving spirit. An unloving spirit. And then, number 26. We see the same thing in the older brother's experience that we saw in the younger brother's experience. And that is the deceptiveness of sin. He misrepresented his father's character. And he misunderstood his father's character as much as did the younger brother. That's the deceptiveness of sin. And finally, number 27. The jealousy of sin. He was jealous that his younger brother was treated better than he was. And so, there was one brother at the end of the story that was finally saved. One brother who had been lost and was saved. But there was one brother at the end of the story that when you come to the end of the story, this brother is still lost. Now, he's at home. He goes to church, but he's still lost. And I want to tell you something. According to the Bible, it's harder to save the older brother than the prodigal son. Notice what Jesus said about it here in Matthew 21. He said to the Pharisees, he said, verse 31, Matthew 21, he said, "Assuredly I say to you that tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you." Why? They know that when they're out there feeding the pigs, they know that they're lost. But the older brother doesn't know that he's lost. But he is. He is absolutely just as much lost as the younger brother, but he doesn't know it. So, what's going to happen? Well, I'll tell you, friends, we don't like to think about this. But we need to think about it before it's too late. What's going to happen is this. Someday, there's going to be many, many prodigal sons that are going to be on the inside the holy city. Not all. Not all prodigal sons come home. I know that. But there will be many who will come back and be saved. And there will also be many, many older brothers who will be on the outside. That maybe haven't committed all the crimes that those prodigal sons did that are on the inside. How is the story going to end? Well, this is a quotation from Ellen White on the end of the story. She asked these questions. Was the elder brother brought to see his own mean, ungrateful, and unloving spirit? Did he come to see that though his brother had done wickedly, he was his brother still? Did the elder son himself repent of his jealousy and hard-heartedness and his lack of filial love? Did he ask his father's forgiveness for so misrepresenting him? Concerning all this, Jesus is silent. For the parable was still enacting, and it rested with his hearers to determine what the outcome should be. And it's still the same today. It's still unraveling, and it rests with us. Whether we're the prodigal son or whether we're the older brother, whichever it is, it rests with us as to how the story is going to end. How is the story going to end in your life? How is the story going to end in my life? How it's going to end rests with us. Before we go, wouldn't it be appropriate for us to pray about this? How do you want the story to end in your life? Whether you're the prodigal son or whether you're the older brother, how do you want the story to end? Well, that's up to each one of us, how the story is going to end in our life. Let's pray before we go. Father in heaven, we pray that you will deliver us from the pit of sin. Oh Lord, we can all see the problems that the younger brother had. Help us to comprehend also the problems that the older brother had. And we pray for a conversion experience that we may be perfect overcomers, that every defect of character may be eliminated from our experience, from our life, from our mind, before it is too late. Oh Lord, we know that the end of the story depends on us. And we look to you now. We pray for your mighty power, for your redeeming power, for your grace, for your divine power through the Holy Spirit to come into our hearts and into our lives. We need to have a revival and a reformation inside so that we can be used by your Holy Spirit to finish your work. And we humbly pray that your Spirit will come into our hearts and transform us and deliver us from the awfulness of sin as we have seen it in this story tonight, and make us pure and holy and ready to meet our Savior when He returns. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.